What's up, everybody? This is Arden Moore, and welcome to Meowy Hour. This show is brought to you each and every Wednesday night by the Cat Fancier Association, and we have a great sponsor, and that is Pet King Brands. You know them, the makers of Zymox and Oratine. We got a great show for you tonight and a great cocktail, and we're going to compare some breeds, and we're going to talk about the three H's of cats. Holy what? That's because our special guest today is the remarkable veterinarian, Dr. Hazel Carney. Say hi to everybody.
Hi there.
I asked her for a brief bio, guys, and know what she described herself as? This is a quote. Now, I'm in the newspaper world back then, so I take quotes very seriously. She describes herself as one of the oldest living cat-only doctors left in captivity. So I think we're going to have some fun today. What do you guys think? And also at this time, I really want to give a pause and applause to the co-pilots of this show, the remarkable all-breed CFA judge, Kathy Black, and also the all-breed CFA judge and editor of Cat Talk, Teresa Kiger. My cats, my ginger boys, Rusty the performer. Hey, Rusty. Hi, buddy. He goes, hi guys, I'm looking for treats. Arden's hidden them again. And pet safety cat Casey, who will come when I shake the treats, are also part of the show. So we're gonna kick it off with some feline facts. Now, we have a good veterinary doctor in the house, so don't give this away, okay? Okay, so these are bet you don't know facts about cats. Number one, did you know that a cat cannot directly see under their nose? So if I'm a mouse, I'm gonna hang out right there, maybe, and hope that the cat can't smell me or that the whiskers aren't using spidey senses to say, there's a mouse down here, right? What do you think of that one, Dr. Hazel?
That's perfectly correct.
All right, one for one. All right, number two. And this is like me. Most cats, like me, don't have much of eyelashes, if they have any. See, I'm blinking. I put mascara on, but you guys still can't tell, right? I always love the people that have those beautiful eyelashes.
I'm in the
eyelashes.
Same boat. Yeah.
So what's the deal? Why don't cats have eyelashes, Dr. Hazel?
I don't know of an explanation for
it. They have a third eyelid, so they don't have to worry about it, maybe.
With the nictitans, that's it. They don't really need them to serve the function of acting as a protective barrier.
Well, I understand, you know, they have the whiskers right up here above their eyes. And sometimes in my pet behavior classes, I'll touch them. And for kids, I teach for kids too. And Casey will close his eye. So it's like a safety mechanism. If something touches those whiskers on the top, they shut their eyes.
Mm-hmm.
So my poor cat, look what I do to him.
Torture. Kitty torture.
Kitty torture.
Yeah. All right. So the third fact. Some believe that if you have a dream about a white cat, good luck will follow. What do you guys say to that? Now, last night, I guess was dreaming about the lackluster snowstorm we had in Dallas. And I was thinking about cats. So maybe white snow cats. And my stimulus check came today.
I had a white cat named Elvis Pursley, and he loved it when it snowed because he was finally camouflaged. That was the only time. And then he learned that he was that much closer to the bird feeder, and he was snatching birds off my bird feeder, which I wasn't happy about. But he would have a blast in the snow, but I've never dreamt about a white cat. So
I
guess I'm not very lucky.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think all cats bring us good luck because they make us better humans. That's my thought. All right. So we want at this time to talk a little bit about our sponsors, Zymox and Oratine. And guys, we're going to have a trivia contest in a little bit, but they're giving away the Zymox shampoo and conditioner. And the conditioner, you can leave on or rinse off. There's going to be the Orotine, a brushless toothpaste gel. All the cats I know are going, yes, thank you, please. Don't stick that thing in my mouth. I want to have good, healthy gums and teeth. So we're very grateful that they're sponsoring that. So we're going to give away a goodie basket to a winner. But at this time, we have a little segment called CFA News. Now, I wish I could do the ticker tape. Ripped from the headlines, scratched from the headlines. I believe, is it Teresa? Are you going to share what's going on?
Yes, it is. Kathy can pull up that image.
Okay.
Yes, so I just wanted to let everybody know that next Wednesday, that's next
Thursday,
I don't know what day it is, January the 21st, the Kitten Coalition in conjunction with CFA is sponsoring a free to everybody webinar on healthy and living environments for kittens.
Nice. And
we know, any of us who work with kittens know just how important it is to, you know, those first couple of, you know, few months of life, especially keep everything clean and make sure that the kitty stays safe. So that information is going to be on the CFA Facebook page. That's Facebook CFA Cats. And it'll be announced on Instagram and other social media. You have the information for tuning in. So
I love that CFA's playing a role in that. That's awesome.
Couldn't have it on Wednesday because it would compete against our show. Right?
Yeah. So we're going to promote them again next week. You know, all right. So last week, I know you're dying to know. Now I'm going to see how good the Dr. Hazel is on this one. We had a trivia question last week, and it was, which is not a common name for catnip? Okay, so which of the three words I'm going to give you, which one is not a common name for catnip? Is it cat mint, cat's wort, or cat's chew? Which one does not make sense? Oh, look at her. It looks like Bambi in headlights. Okay.
Well, I know cat mint is correct.
Okay. Very good.
What was the middle term?
Cat wort, catwort. Think British. They would probably do that.
Right. I would say that's acceptable.
But cat's chew, I was just making up a word.
No.
All right.
Good job.
Thank you. So, Kathy, please tell us, who's the winner of the gift basket provided by Pet King Brands, the Zymox and the Orotine? Do you have a winner?
Yes. Yeah, that's Denise Mangold. And has been contacted. I have her address. So congratulations to Denise for having the correct answer.
And go ahead and show the gift basket because we're up for grabs for this next question. You ready if we can show that?
Yeah, got it.
Okay. There's a new show on Fox and it's called Call Me Cat. And it stars the gal from the Big Bang Theory. Remember the one that played Amy Farrah Fowler?
Yes.
It is Mayim Bialik. She is a neuroscientist. She has a PhD, and she has great comedic timing. She plays this character called Kat, C-A-K-A-T, who is operating a cat cafe. And it has people like Leslie Jordan, you know, the little guy that has this beautiful Southern voice that seems to be always in good shows with timing. Have you seen that show yet, Dr. Hazel? Call Me Kat? It just started in January. It's on Fox. So I'm going to ask you, she plays the owner of a cat cafe, but what city is it? So here you go, guys. Here's your choices. And don't worry, since you've not seen the show, you don't have to answer the question, Dr. Hazel, because this is a prize that'll be announced next week. Okay. Is the cat cafe in Albuquerque, New Mexico? Chattanooga, Tennessee, Jacksonville, Florida, or Louisville, Kentucky?
And I've watched the show, and I don't know where the cafe is, to be honest with you. So you'd have to Google this.
Albuquerque, New Mexico, Chattanooga, Tennessee, Jacksonville, Florida, or Louisville, Kentucky? Now, did I say it with a straight poker face?
Yep.
All right. Good, good. All right. The first show, she kind of talks to the camera a lot. The second episode, it was a little bit better. I always say give a new show two or three tries because they got to get their feet going and their characters developed. But what do you think, Dr. Hazel, about a show taking place in a cat cafe? We've come a long way, meow, haven't we?
Oh, truly. It could be very entertaining as well as promoting the concept of the cat cafes, which are increasing adoption and everything. So it could be a very positive event.
I love it. I love it. And let's talk a little bit about Dr. Hazel Carney. We could fill this show with all her accolades and things that she has done for our cats. She's had quite a background. We're going to get into that. But right now, she is on staff at the West Vet Emergency and Specialty Center. It's in Idaho. It's kind of near the Oregon border. She's also a member of the American Association of Feline Practitioners. She started as a veterinary technician. There's a lot of other things, goodies. I loved your quote, how you described yourself as the oldest living cat-only doctor left in captivity. So her middle name is Methuselah. Okay, everybody. All right. She ages very well. She's probably just on her sixth life. You got three more to go, Dr. Hazel.
Oh, good. That I like that.
And I also love the fact that she is a brainiac, but she also is very grounded. So let's ask the good doctor, what are the very stylish names of her three cats she shares with her husband, James, in their home in Idaho? Go ahead.
Calamity Jane, Wyatt Earp, and Hi-Ho Silver.
I sense a theme here, don't you guys?
They're all cowboys.
They're all cowboys.
So cowgirls.
You're on a ranch, right?
Yes.
How big is this ranch?
325 acres.
That's a lot of mowing.
Thank goodness the cows do that job.
Oh my gosh. So back up the bus. What made you say, I want to become a veterinarian and then, hey, I want to specialize in feline medicine?
My mom had a picture of me at about 15 months of age on a deck chair in Florida with a stray cat. So apparently I've always had some connection with cats. And my husband swears we can walk down the middle of any town in the United States in the middle of the night and I'll find a cat.
Wow.
And in vet school, Shaw, the original Persian that was the source of that virus we identified, no one understood cat behavior. And when we finally lost Shaw, I made him a promise that I would just try to learn as much as I could to pay him back for his patience with us through the years.
Well, let's talk about that, Shaw, because in 86, you were dealing with, go to hyperthyroidism in a little bit. 3 years later, 1989, when she was only 10, everybody. She published the first report about, this sounds disgusting, but it's a breakthrough, the wart virus in cats. For us mere mortals, what does that mean and why is that so significant?
Almost all species have a wart. I mean, people have warts. And the cat wart virus had never been found before. It causes very specific skin lesions that if they are not addressed early can progress to a type of skin cancer.
Oh, okay. Wow. So what happened? How did you say, I found it?
My husband's PhD is in virology.
Wow, so you guys are exciting at dinner, past the immunology salt, right?
Exactly. So when we biopsied these strange greasy plaques on dear Shaw, lo and behold, there were inclusions and he said, there's a virus in there. So we did electron microscopy. We identified the the virus. And then a friend did immunohistochemistry and various testing to show that it was a unique virus.
Wow, that's impressive. I mean, you guys have been married for more than 3 decades, right?
Yes, almost 40 years.
Congratulations. I mean, did he have you at immunology? I mean, what won him over? I can just see the conversation. Hi, my name is James. Hi, my name is Hazel. Let's talk chemistry and biology. Yay!
Oh, no. He was just good looking cowboy in vet school.
Okay. All right. Good. All right. So we want to give a little kudos to Dr. James because he's a PhD and a DVM, correct?
Yes.
That's pretty impressive. All right. But we have a CFA connection. Now, I'm trying to be a good host and find out good things to share. And every one of you who are in CFA, who have a cattery, or who are a judge, or loves to go to a CFA show, the good doctor, way back when she was in grad school and going, I guess you were a veterinary technician before you became a veterinarian, tell us your CFA connection.
I actually had a Persian cattery when I was in graduate school.
Okay. And I understand because I've been paying attention to Kathy and Teresa every time they do a breed profile. There's a lot of different types of Persians. So what kind did you have?
He was a chinchilla silver Persian.
Okay.
And then I had a couple of females. We had probably half dozen litters total in my career as a breeder, but it was a very good learning experience. Shaw was truly one of those cats that I bonded with. Mm-hmm. He had every behavioral problem known to catdom for which we had no answers.
Okay. Step in here, Kathy. What kind of question you want to ask her about?
Well, I was going to ask her about the cat wart. So how was this virus transmitted?
Yeah.
It is most commonly transmitted through cat to cat. You know, a cat has it, rubs on another cat in a lesion or a scratch or something like that. And if the other cat is immunosuppressed, it manifests.
Okay. So it's something that they may be living with, but until they're suppressed for some reason, it doesn't really rear its ugly head.
Exactly. Okay. They can be very asymptomatic as carriers.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Interesting.
And what about, you want to ask her any questions about her cattery? Because...
Well, you gave us her cattery name earlier. You might say it on the air for people that might know that are Persian line chasers.
Oh, wow. J-A, it's actually Jaipur. Jaipur.
Okay.
Hi.
And breeding silvers is not an easy task, as I'm sure you figured out.
Yes.
And breeding Persians can be challenging, too. So you probably learned some baby tricks and how to deal with small kittens, which I think every veterinarian should have that experience because they don't teach you much in vet school from what I learned about rearing kittens. So you've got some firsthand knowledge there, which I'm sure you bring into your practice.
Yes.
Oh, that's great. Yeah. Well, I always call the first year of a kitten's life the wonder year because you wonder where your sanity went.
That's a great description.
All right. Well, we promised you that we're gonna poke the brain cells of Dr. Hazel Carney, and we've got three H's to cover. The first one is hyperthyroidism. And for all you guys out there, dogs get hypothyroidism generally. Cats are more apt to get hyperthyroidism. Just think of the word per. That's not scientific, but that's how I make the distinction. But talk about the thyroid gland and what role that you played when you, I believe you were at, weren't you at Louisiana State when some things happened with hyperthyroidism?
Yes, we started treating cats with radioactive iodine while my husband and I were in Baton Rouge.
Okay.
So I was an adjunct professor there And we worked with the school to develop this program of treatment back early when I-131 was not available in a lot of locations.
So if in the most simplest, because I'm listening and trying to comprehend, what the heck is hyperthyroidism? And what are some telltale signs? Because I've had two cats that have had it. We've done the radioactive iodine on one, and another one was able to do it with medications like tapazole. So tell us a little bit about what the heck it is and why all of us who have a cat need to pay attention.
Hyperthyroidism is the clinical manifestation of the cat's thyroid gland going into warp speed.
Okay.
And the thyroid hormone controls the speed at which the whole body runs. So the more hormone, the faster everything goes in the cat's body. That leads to the signs you see.
Okay.
Initially, you don't see much other than the cat's just more awake, more interactive. The sofa slug all of a sudden starts to show interest in a toy.
Okay.
If you become more active, you need more groceries. So your appetite starts to improve.
Okay.
Some cats get totally out of control, needing more and more and more calories. Others, because they're moving around, are warmer. They go sleep in a little cooler area instead of always laying in that sunbeam.
Yeah.
They drink more. Consequently, there's more urine in the litter box. Over time, their stool actually can improve because they are drinking more water. They are eating more. So if your typically constipated cat no longer needs Miralax, it may be the result of hyperthyroidism. A lot of these signs are very, very subtle initially, and they work up so we don't notice them.
Okay.
Another really unusual thing is if another cat in the household decides to quit using the litter box, it may be because his roommate has developed hyperthyroidism and that cat's urine smells different to the other resident. It's like, ooh, wait a minute, where's the new cat in the house that I can't find?
Oh, now that's pretty fascinating. I mean, it's like, can somebody light some candles, please? You know? Wow, I didn't know that. That's a pretty interesting sign. And it can happen to middle and senior age, typically more cats, right?
Typically older cats, as their age increases, the incidence increases. We very rarely will see them down around 5 years of age, a little bit more around 7, 8. Once you hit the 9 and above, you really have a great risk. And in totally, about 10% of cats in the United States are diagnosed with the disease.
Well, years ago, I had a gray cat. I said he looked like this Persian right there, but he definitely was a mutt cat. Her name was Samantha, Sam, the wild woman. And she all of a sudden was kind of built like a tank. And she started slimming down and energetic. And I falsely said to myself, made myself believe it, I must be a miracle worker. I have done something to help this cat become a kitten again and lose weight.
Oh, yes.
No.
Classic sign. They start to lose weight in spite of eating a lot.
Some
of them also do a lot more squalling. Talk about muttering in the middle of the night. You name it.
Okay. So is there any preventative yet for hyperthyroidism?
No. We do not yet know the exact cause.
Okay.
We suspect that the changes occur 2 to 3 years before we see even the first sign of disease in many cats. Mm-hmm. And no, we really cannot prevent it until we figure out what causes it.
So with my second cat, all right, all you people coming up with clever cat names, laugh. Callie the...
Calico.
I started seeing some things and we were able to catch it. And I actually did the radioactive iodine. I didn't, my veterinarian did. And I was laughing because the cost of it was the same amount as I got for a royalty for some of my books. and I had like $10 left over, so I bought a Happy Meal at McDonald's. But I think I made money well spent. But it's zapping of the thyroid, but it's pretty effective, right?
Yes. It averages about 96% success in curing the disease.
Okay. For others, though, there is also, I know there's therapeutic diets out there by some of the major food companies that can help stave off or minimize the symptoms. But then you get, I don't know how, what do you say? Is it called tapazole or methimazole? What is the thing that you put in the one ear in the morning and one ear in the evening?
Methimazole is the chemical name.
Thank you.
Tapazole is one trade name.
Okay.
Methimazole is another trade name.
But I butchered that. But for all the people out there who are going to cat shows when it is safe to do so or travel, and you got to hire a pet sitter for your home, this is a cat that needs at least two visits, right? A day.
Yes.
So tell us how that works. How's that transmission into the capillaries and the ears?
It's simple absorption across the skin into the bloodstream.
Okay. Kathy, have you ever had a cat with hyperthyroidism?
No, mine are all fat and lazy.
I hope you never have it. But it did extend the life of my two cats, Samantha and Callie, and I was very, very grateful for that. Is there any parting message you want to say about hyperthyroidism to all our cat people? We got people tuning in from all over the world.
The key to the aging cat is know what they typically do and realize that they don't make a change in their usual patterns without a cause.
Right.
And of all the diseases that we see in aging cats, hyperthyroidism is about the only one that makes them initially look and act like they feel better.
That's interesting. We're talking with Dr. Hazel Carney, guys. She is practices feline medicine at the West Vet Emergency and Specialty Center. It's in Idaho. And you live in a really tiny, cramped apartment, right?
Nope.
How big is your
space? I live in a very small house on a ranch.
Okay. And how many acres again?
325.
Okay, cool. That's about 324 and three quarters more than where I am.
Do you have buffalo or just cattle?
Just cattle.
Okay. And I know we talked about your three cats. How did they get the cowboy names, and how did you get Wyatt or Calamity Jane and Hi-Lo Silver?
My husband and I have named all of our cats after cowboys since we adopted the very first Lavender Lynx Point from the Cheyenne, Wyoming Humane Society.
Wow.
And it's just, they connect with us.
Do they wear cowboy hats?
No, most of them cut it off at boots.
Oh no, puss in boots? No. Really?
No, I'm joking.
All right, and what are their personalities like?
Across the board, we've had a lot of Lavender Lynx Points. They're all lush, easygoing, definitely the last of the great relaxed cats.
Okay.
Hi-Ho Silver is a classic bullseye silver tabby. He's grew up on a calf raising facility, starving to death. So he's busy, 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 you name it. He chases everything. Calamity Jane, poor little gal, came dragging up out of the pasture with a trap on her foot. And we hadn't put a trap out at our ranch the whole 25 years we've owned it. So we don't know where she found it, but she's a black and white short hair, very easygoing, loves to be in the shop with my husband working and anything like that. Overall, everyone we've had since the cattery have all been strays that somebody dumped off or we found.
You have a dog too, don't you?
We do. We have a border collie that's
not named Kitty or anything, right?
No. Okay. She came to us named Bailey.
Bailey. And how does Bailey fit in the hierarchy with your three cowboy cats?
Oh, she likes them. She actually gets along beautifully with them. She never looked cross-eyed, and she was so very similar to our 15-year-old border collie we lost about a year ago that I think she snuck in because the cats couldn't. She doesn't smell that different. Maybe she just rolled in something. So she snuck in the back door easily.
I always wonder, what do you think if you could, I know this is making you anthropomorphize, but you got a lot of credentials and Vanna White initials after your name, but do you think cats know you're a veterinarian and they're like, yeah, I have a doctor in the house. I'm good.
No, uh-uh. They see me in my pajamas and everything else too much.
One thing I love that you do for some of your clients, you give them a little present with catnip in it. Can you talk about your craft skills?
I can sew a lot of things. And I brought one. This is just a little bitty muslin bag.
Okay.
Stuffed with a mixture of calming herbs that I mix up and make for them.
What do you think about that, Kathy? How would you like to go to a veterinarian who not only gets your cat healthy, but shows that she's like the Martha Stewart of cat veterinarians?
I think it's a very special touch, and it just shows that she understands cats and she cares about them, and she wants these cats to be relaxed and happy, and I think every vet wants that for the cats they see in their clinic.
So it's 2021, Dr. Hazel Carney. Is this a good time to be a cat?
To me, anytime's a good time to be a cat. I hope I come back as one.
Okay. But I mean, things have come a long way since you began as a veterinarian. Wouldn't you say, as far as understanding how cats think and being able to deal with issues because they hide pain? I mean, it seems like we're just slowly lifting off the lid in a good way.
Oh, definitely. When I look at the explosion of knowledge in my 40 years of veterinary medicine, it's fabulous for the cat. We can truly do things to gild their golden years, improve their quality of life, make their veterinarian their friend. We have a lot of opportunities.
And we have a dog in the house. This is Destiny. This is Kathy, has always had cats. And this dog is smaller than a cat. How much does Destiny weigh?
She's still 5.5.
Wow. I felt the earth move. Wait a minute. Hang on. So all your cats are bigger than her, right?
Yes. Oh, yeah. One is 3 times bigger than her. So, yeah.
All right. Where can people find out more about you, Dr. Hazel? Can you give us a link or a Facebook or something?
www.westvet.net.
Okay, www.westvet.net. Now, we're also going to talk about another H today, and that's a big one, house soiling. So want us to be a little bit like cat detectives, right?
Yes.
So are there some good tips you can give us, just like you did for the hyperthyroidism, that we can use to be able to share with our veterinarian to kind of figure out what's going on?
Always take a house plan drawing to your veterinarian if you have a house soiling cat.
Okay.
That shows the location of all your cat's resources. Okay. Meaning litter box, water bowl, food bowl, cat tree, sleeping areas, and overlay that with markings of where the cat house soils.
Oh, good. I like that. All right.
That's a good suggestion.
Yeah. And a cat that's missing the litter box, everybody thinks they're doing it out of spite. Will you please burst that myth?
Oh, if I could kill one myth, that would be it.
Okay, good.
The cat never does it without a true reason, whether it's social, environmental, or medical. The cat is trying to tell you something is wrong in its world.
Okay, good. So missing the litter box, there's where you have to start assembling the clues. I love that of laying out where your layout of resources are and where the piddles are happening. Also, people know about litter box math. It's my favorite math, you know, I can do it. So can you tell people kindly that have more than one cat, what is litter box math?
And that's the scrambled egg theory, one per cat and one for company. Okay. No, it's the idea, and that applies to every floor in the house.
Wow.
You'll never go wrong with that number. We do now know that some very closely bonded cats will actually be happy with one cat for the bonded pair.
More
litter boxes are always better. And the key is that those litter boxes are in separate locations. They can't just be eight lined up against the wall in the basement.
Thank you. Well, I have three cats plus one-eyed Mort, who's FIV, so he's got his own suite in our house. So we have litter boxes in different locations, and we scoop them out every day. And that's the other thing. I get a little nervous when people say, well, I've got one of those automated litter machines, scooping. I'm like, one of the nicest things I think I can do for my cats is to scoop their litter box. It doesn't take a lot of time. I was always terrified that they'd be in there with their newspaper or doing their crossword puzzle, getting ready to dump, and the machine malfunctions. And now you got a cat too scared to go in a litter box. So,
oh yes.
What's your thoughts on litter boxes and the fact that there's so many different designs now? You don't have to look like a house full of litter boxes, right?
You don't have to. The key is you want easily accessible litter boxes in safe locations, meaning the cat wants at least two escape routes from the litter box.
Okay. All right.
That is the biggest problem with totally confined litter boxes, such as the ones in pieces of furniture where there's only one door.
Oh, okay. All right.
If a cat gets attacked inside of one of those enclosed pieces of furniture, then it may likely house soil because it doesn't go back to where it got beat up the last time.
Yeah, I certainly would feel the same.
Right.
Well, I also know that, like in our house, we've got those gates that are easy, but there's also things like door hinges so that typically the dog, sorry, Destiny, is bigger than the cats in the house. So the cats can slip through these door ajars or the gates with the little hole in it so they can go in. Because our 90-pound dog, Bujo, would love to snack on some of the contributions from Casey and Rusty. But we have prevented that. So that's another big one, right?
Oh, yes, definitely. Keeping the dog or any cat that may be protecting that litter box or defending it or whatever he thinks he's doing. You know, he doesn't want to share. Sometimes you even have to put in your electronic collars to let only one cat into a room where the litter box is located. Anything like that that you can do to just ensure safety in the latrine.
So we're continuing this poop fest. Okay, when should you be calling a veterinarian when you're scooping the litter? Either urine or feces. When is you see an uh-oh? What's an uh-oh in your mind? A medical emergency.
No urine is definitely a big red flag.
Okay, good.
Or straining and no urine. Right.
Right. So, but if you're just going in and scooping, you're not scooping when the cat's there. So lack of it. If you're in there with the cat and they're squatting and can't produce anything, by all means, yes. That's terrible, terrible, terrible risk for life.
Yeah, like their urethra, especially the boy kitties. I jokingly say it looks like a road rally race. There's some curves. Mm-hmm. And there's a place where there could be crystals or blockages. Did I do it? Probably not very medically sounding, but am I getting the right track?
Oh, you're definitely headed in the right direction.
Okay.
Or there doesn't even have to be material in the urethra. Sometimes it hurts and it just spasms and won't let, and it can spasm shut.
Okay, let's continue P, because I love liquid gold. You guys as veterinarians, you call urine liquid gold, right?
Definitely.
Yeah, see, I've been listening. I love that because it tells you so much. So what happens if you see a little blood in the urine?
There again, that's an indication of underlying inflammation somewhere in the cat's urinary tract, notoriously lower tract.
So bring it in, right? Bring that sample in.
Oh, definitely. Bring it in.
Well, let's go to poop, because I love poop. I'm a poopologist. When I teach my pet first aid classes, I teach that you as a veterinarian, you score it on a scale of 1 to 7, and you want like a glistening Tootsie Roll, like 3 or 4. You don't want the milk duds, number 1, and you don't want the stinky chocolate milkshake, number 7. How's that? Do you think I could be a veterinary professor?
Sounds like you've been looking at the poop charts.
But poop's form is a big deal. So what would be a poop emergency? Sorry.
Again, you know, straining or lack of production.
Okay.
Persistent grades, you know, 5 to 7, watery stool dehydrates the cat very quickly if it lasts any length of time. The other end, little bitty tiny hard balls, are also an indication of either underlying severe dehydration or lack of gut motility.
Okay, very good. So my scale was right. Milk duds to chocolate shakes.
Exactly.
With a glistening Tootsie Roll in the middle. There you go. All right.
The number one thing that we learn as when we're cat breeders is dehydration is the number one killer. So you always have to be very cautious and aware of your cat's hydration. And I've just had senior girls that have gotten like little bladder infections or urinary tract infections, and it hurts when they have to go. So they end up not using the box because the box hurt them. So they try to go over here, but that hurts too. And they try to go over here and that hurts too. And, you know, when you spot that, then you know. They're dealing with an issue. So it's,
definitely.
Yeah. Little azo will help a little bit till you get to the vet. But that's
so always. The takeaway here, guys, is we got to watch the litter box activity and what's the deviations. So I think being a good cat mom or a good cat dad is really paying attention to what's normal and not, correct?
That's definitely it. And one hint for increasing water intake, make sure people understand that the food and water bowls need to be in separate locations.
And tell us why, good doctor.
Because cats normally won't eat and drink in the same location. Wow. And naturally, whether they are scared that if they stay too long, they'll be more vulnerable to attack, or whether they're trying to prevent contamination of water with food substance, we're unsure, but for some reason they just don't do it naturally. So if we stick the two side by side, they drink much less than they will if it's somewhere else in the house.
I like that. What do you think of that one, Kathy?
I've always done that. My cats, they'll have several water bowls in the house and they always want the one farthest from their food or the dog's water bowl now. But and don't put it close to the litter box either. I think
definitely not.
You'd be surprised how many people don't. They throw all that stuff in the laundry room and they expect the cat to like it all in that one little spot, and that's just not always the case either.
Oh, not at all.
Hey guys, we're speaking with Dr. Hazel Carney. She's at the West Vet Emergency and Specialty Center in Idaho. Really guys, I've learned a lot today, and some things you've refreshed my memory. I really do salute you, Dr. Hazel, for what you're doing for cats and for us feeble two-leggers. You really are making a difference and I salute you. You may be the oldest living cat-only doctor left in captivity, but you've captivated our attention. So I really thank you for that. We're gonna have you stick around because now it's time for Teresa and Kathy to compare two of the big boys in the cat world. We're talking about the Maine Coon and the Norwegian Forest Cat. So ladies, take it away.
Well, and I definitely wanna bring up, since we're talking about litter boxes, when you have a big breed cat, You have to get big boxes. These cats don't like to use small boxes. So that's another thing to always keep in mind too, because half the time they'll just do it out of the side because the box is not big enough. So,
they don't fit.
Yeah, they don't fit. Okay, so we were we decided this year to not just feature our pedigree breed, but also do some fun stuff like doing some comparisons. And probably the two breeds that most people get confused about, we did the American Shorthair and the British Shorthair last week. This week we're going to do the Maine Coon, which is on the left, versus a Norwegian Forest Cat on the right. So I've highlighted some different features about these cats. Like last week we focused on two features, so we're going to kind of focus on two features this week too. Just overall from the standard, the Maine Coon is a solid, rugged cat that can endure a harsh environment. It is a native long-haired cat of North America, so it was developed in the Northeast where we can have some cold winters, and it has a shaggy coat, and there's actually more points on the shagginess of the coat in a Maine Coon than there is a Persian's coat, just the regular points. So we definitely want to keep that shaggy coat in the breed. And the head is medium in width, slightly longer than it is wide, with a squareness to the muzzle. And the Norwegian is also a sturdy cat, but it has a double coat, and it has an equilateral triangle shape to the head and a straight profile. So we're going to talk about mostly the head structure as being the difference between these two cats, because there's 50 points on the Norwegian Forest Cat head. So they really want that head to be distinctive and not look like a Maine Coon head. So here, this is a little more square. It's slightly longer than it is wide with that squared off muzzle. And the Norwegian has that triangle shape, equilateral triangle shape to the head with that straight profile. I love this drawing because it really shows the lines and the length of the head and how straight this is versus the concavity that we have with this profile. Here's the profile shot for you. Here's the Maine Coon. It's got a nice gentle concavity to it, where with the Norwegian Forest Cat, we have that beautiful straight profile. The eyes are not as distinctive from each other. The standard says the Maine Coons are large, expressive, wide-set, open ovals. And the Norwegian describes theirs as a large almond, open and expressive. So we have large, open, and expressive on both of these breeds. The difference is these are oval, these are more almond. So eye shape can vary between cats, so it's not really something you're going to look at that cat and say, that's a Norwegian based on its eye shape. It's more like how it fits into the head with the overall shape of the head. The body on the Maine Coon says medium to large. And I always point this out when I'm judging the Maine Coons, because the Persians, their standard says large to medium, which people say, well, why? Well, they don't want the Persians to become miniaturized and don't want us to reward a Maine Coon just because it's big. Okay. So I think that's the reason why the standards are worded that way. But it says medium to large. That also helps to account for the females, long with all parts to create a well-balanced rectangle. So you can really see the rectangular shape with this Maine Coon. The Norwegians don't really describe if it's a square or a rectangle or anything like that. It just says it's moderate in length. So that gives you a wide variety. And there's different breeders that will focus on cats being a little shorter or a little longer. Kind of the European lines tend to be a little longer in the body. But one thing I do want to point out, it says depth of flank. And that is this part of the body right here. And that is very different than the way the Maine Coon hind leg is set. They do not have this depth of flank that you will find in the Norwegian. So they're both broad-chested. They're both very muscled, large cats. But the main difference between the two is you definitely have this long rectangular shape with the Maine Coons, and you have that depth of flank with the Norwegian Forest Cat. Now when it talks about the coat of the Maine Coon is heavy and shaggy, And so it's not going to be an all over length. And it just kind of talks about the frontal ruff, and it talks about it being silky with the coat falling smoothly. So when we go back to this cat, you can see the coat really just kind of shows you that body proportions. It's not standing away from the body. It's lying smoothly. The Norwegian forest cat, being a double coat, is going to be covered with those longer glossy hairs with the undercoat underneath there. It has a bib, it has a collar, it has the mutton chops, it has the ruff, it has the breeches. Okay, so all of that's going to be dependent on weather and climate and the maturity of the cat. I wanted to show quickly a very furry, hairy cat, Maine Coon, that's got a lot of coat, right?
Yeah.
And a Norwegian that has a lot of coat. So when you're just looking at these two, it's very difficult to say, oh, this is a Maine Coon coat, this is a Norwegian coat. You have to really get your hands on it because the texture is different. But this cat does have the more depth and wooliness to that coat, where with the Maine Coon, it kind of lays more flat with the body. And here's another Maine Coon that's got a lot of nice coat, nice ruff across, nice fuzzy, you know, big bushy tail and the belly hair. But look at this Norwegian. You can just tell the density to that double coat, even though it's a white cat. And I love the profile on this cat. You can really see that beautiful equilateral triangle shape to the head, where this cat, you can really see the nice Maine Coon head with that squared off muzzle. And then people get hung up on colors, and, you know, so we have to talk about that. They're, you know, the only colors that these cats don't come in are the Siamese colors with the pointed gene. So here's a cameo tabby in white. Here's a red tabby in white. The Norwegian, this one is obviously living in a cold climate. Look at all that coat, how thick it is. But between the head structure, the coat, the body, you can really see the difference between these two cats. And so hopefully, by doing this side-by-side comparison, people have started realizing that you just look at the head structure and look at the body shape and look at the coat texture and density, then you'll be able to easily identify the Maine Coon from the Norwegian. Did you want to add anything, Teresa?
The only couple of things that I can think of, when I think in cats' bodies, in geometric terms. So when I think of Maine Coons, I think of squares and rectangles all over that body. And you did a great job pointing that out. And then with the Norwegian forest cat, it's triangles, triangles, triangles. Angles everywhere. And yeah, the
Maine geometry.
Yeah. Well, and the Maine Coon's coat is really very unique. I often remark that Farrah Fawcett would be very proud of a good Maine Coon coat, because it is absolutely in, you know, classic 70s style layers.
Is that Phoebe interrupting with that tail action?
Yes, that was the Russian blue tail cruising.
Well, you know what, guys? I really like you doing these breed comparisons. What'd you think of that, Dr. Hazel?
I think it's great. I enjoyed seeing it, and I appreciate, too, Kathy mentioning that these much bigger cats do need much bigger litter boxes.
Yes.
Before we go any further, Arden, can I quickly also announce the other winners from last week?
Yes, please.
Okay, so we had the cat treat basket. Remember the cat treat basket?
Please.
Okay, so Lily Desmond, Tracy Arvidson, and Teddy Lilly, they won the cat treat basket, and Karen Heemstra won the dog basket. Remember the piece of pizza or the hot dog or the, what was, there you go, yes. And so Karen Heemstra was the winner of the dog basket. So everybody's been contacted. Thank you for getting back to me, everyone. Hopefully your gifts will be arriving soon.
And they were coming to you guys from our guest last week, which was Geraldine Chata, yes, who's with Meowy Wanna and now Doggy Wanna, organic catnip. I thought she was a lot of fun. And so thank you for sharing that. All right. I guess we're going to, can we put up the first aid?
Yes, you bet.
Okay. I feel nervous. There's a veterinarian in the house. Dr. Hazel, one thing I'm very passionate about, and that is helping people, whether they're cat breeders, cat judges, mutt cat owners, veterinarians, vet tech, first responders. I really enjoy teaching veterinary approved pet first aid. I have two different kinds of programs, one with dog and cat. So my dog Kona and Casey are in that one. And then the other one, we started creating a cat only first aid and CPR. I am a fear-free certified professional, and we do teach a lot about how to reduce fear, anxiety, and stress in cats, especially when they're injured with their flexible spines. So Kathy and Teresa actually took my class and got a two-year certificate, and they still talk to me. So I think it was okay, Dr. Hazel. What do you think?
I think it sounds great. Yes, it's a wonderful program.
So these are your teachers. What do you think of that?
Very handsome.
They're my ginger boys. But Casey actually purrs when we're doing the mock chest compressions.
Wow.
And it's hilarious. And when we're doing an injury, like on a front leg, he actually sticks his leg out. Like, okay, whatever. I know it's happening.
Yeah. But, so when is your next program?
Okay, so the cat one, we're going to do it on a Monday night, everybody. It's going to be January 25th, and it's going to be from 5 to 8 Central Time. Go to that Pet First Aid for you to sign up. And if you're like people like Kathy, who have dogs too, we're doing a full dog-cat program. And that'll be Saturday, January 23rd from about 11 to 3:30 on Central Time. I also teach a two-day instructor program with Pro Pet Hero for people that are interested in becoming pet first aid instructors. I'm a master instructor. So I'm always working with veterinarians. Before COVID, I would give up a night on a weekend every 2 or 3 months and hang out with Dr. Deborah or Dr. Mike, ER veterinarians, and learn even more. So I look forward to getting back to that. So I'm a student and a teacher, guys, and I tell really bad jokes in class. So I hope you'll join us. We have a little bit of time left, so I'm going to make a very quick cocktail. You've known it as the Cuba Libre. Cuba Libre typically has rum and Coca-Cola, and it dates back to the Spanish-American War of 1898. When American soldiers were in Cuba and they learned about a refreshing drink. And I'm not kidding, Bacardi, the guys that created Bacardi rum, got together with the people that developed Coca-Cola and they made this drink. So we're gonna have a little spin-off on it. We're calling this the Kitty Libra cocktail as we pay homage to this Cuban favorite with a feline twist. I want you to check out this graphic. This is done by the very talented Teresa Kiger. Let's give a big pause and applause to Teresa for creating this. Here's how we do it, guys. You can take a regular cocktail or rock glass like this, or a tall glass. I've already gotten a couple of limes cut up. I love this, the muddle master. You want to really get it in there, so you muddle it. Then you add your ice, because ice is very nice. I'm laughing because there's probably nothing here to tempt Rusty and Casey tonight, because there's no whipped cream in it. So then you can use any kind of rum. We typically like to do light rum for this. So you're going to do 2 ounces, which is these two shots. I got this measured out. So I'm going to put in 1, 2. And just to mix up this drink a little bit, because now I live in Texas, and Texas is the land of Dr. Pepper. So, and I'm a chick, so of course I have to have it diet Dr. Pepper. So then you add the Dr. Pepper, and you just lightly stir it together because you got carbonation here. Be nice to yourself. And then you just rim the glass with a little lime. And at this time, I want us all to raise our glass, whether it's a Cuba Kitty Libra, water, coffee, doesn't matter. And at this time, let us toast to all cats that make us humans better. Cheers.
Cheers.
I also, it's very refreshing. And I kind of like hitting it with the Dr. Pepper. What'd you think of that little foray, Kathy?
I love it. Sounds good.
Am I going to get you to drink a Kitty Libra sometime, Dr. Hazel?
Oh, yes. That sounds like a fun drink.
Guys, we're getting close to running out of time, so quickly, I want to, at this time, thank our sponsors, Pet King Brand, the maker of Zymox and Orotine, my co-pilots, Kathy Black and Teresa Kiger, my co-host, Casey and Rusty, and of course, our very, very special guest today, Dr. Hazel Carney. Thank you so much for being here, Dr. Hazel. You survived. Oh,
thank you for the opportunity. This was such fun. Y'all are doing a really good service to the cats.
Thank you. We work hard at that. Next week, our guest is Rebecca Rose. She's a biochemist. She's a brainiac too. And she's with In Clover. So until next time, this is your host, Arden Moore, saying we'll see you same cat channel, same cat time. We'll see you on Meowy Hour. Thank you, everybody.
Bye-bye.